the House of Representatives, the Republican House, just voting to demand that the Justice Department do a better job producing documents. That after a contentious House Judiciary Committee hearing. We'll take you back there live as soon as possible. A confrontation between Republicans and the Deputy Attorney General, principally, but also the Director of the FBI. Rod Rosenstein locked in a public feud with House Republicans over their demands that the government produce documents about the Russia investigation, specifically about the counterintelligence investigation into the Trump campaign. Republicans say Rosenstein and the FBI and the Justice Department are hiding things. Rosenstein pushing back repeatedly, at times angrily, at that suggestion.
I am the Deputy Attorney General of the United States, okay? I'm not the person doing the redacting.
You're the boss, Mr. Rosenstein.
That's correct. And my job is to make sure that we respond to your concerns.
Department of Justice.
Me because I'm telling the truth and I'm under oath. And if you want to put somebody else under oath and they have something different,
I know these staff members.
Respond.
House Republicans also putting the special counsel investigation under the microscope. The special counsel investigation, of course, is secretive. Robert Mueller speaks in court documents, not on TV. But Republicans say they're tired of waiting and they need Mueller, in their view, to fill in the blanks and do it quickly.
We've seen the bias. We need to see the evidence. If you have evidence of wrongdoing by any member of the Trump campaign, present it to the damn grand jury. If you have evidence that this president acted inappropriately, present it to the American people. There's an old saying that justice delayed is justice denied. I think right now all of us are being denied. Whatever you got, finish it the hell up, because this country is being torn apart.
Again, that contentious hearing and a break right now. We'll get back to it momentarily. CNN's Manu Raju up on Capitol Hill. Manu, the temper's flaring. We know that these Republicans, some of them, don't trust Mr. Rosenstein and Mr. Ray. Take us inside that committee room again and what you're hearing in the hallways.
Well, this is a partisan fight that is intensifying by the moment, John. Just moments ago, as you mentioned, the House passing this resolution by a party line vote, a vote of 226 to 183, compelling the Justice Department, actually calling on the Justice Department to provide these documents about the Russia investigation, about the Clinton investigation by July 6th. Now, what does that mean practically? It's a symbolic threat, because if Rosenstein does not provide the documents to the satisfaction of the Republicans, expect some punitive steps to be taken by this House, potentially holding Rod Rosenstein in contempt of Congress, maybe even going as far as trying to impeach Rod Rosenstein, as some conservatives have called for. But all of this fight between the House Republicans and Rod Rosenstein has just been intensifying, as we saw in this very, very tense public hearing over the last several hours. Republicans saying not enough information has been provided to their committees about the Russia investigation, about the Clinton investigation. Rosenstein, backed up by FBI Director Christopher Wray, said they have been responding to the tune of hundreds, 880,000 pages of documents. They say 100 employees have been working around the clock to provide this information, and that they are responding to, quote, legitimate requests from Congress. This has just not been to the satisfaction of the Republicans on this committee, and Democrats, John, saying this is all part of an attempt to undercut the Mueller investigation, to undercut Rod Rosenstein, and that's why that they're pushing back and giving Rod Rosenstein some defense, but seriously, not Rod Rosenstein not quelling any of his Republican critics so far this morning, John.
Certainly not. And again, we'll be back in that hearing momentarily. In the meantime, let's bring in our crime and justice reporter, Evan Perez. Evan, as you're watching this play out, the deputy attorney general, he tried to stay calm. He got a little angry at other points. His integrity, his credibility are being questioned by members of the interesting part about this, his own political party.
That's right, John. I mean, look, this is a man, Rod Rosenstein, is someone who I've known probably close to a decade. And I've never seen him so fiery and so passionate, really, because he was coming under personal attack. Again, as you mentioned, the fact is he is a Trump appointee. He's a lifelong Republican. Christopher Wray, the FBI director, is the same. He's a Republican who served in the Bush administration. I knew him then when he was in the criminal division at the Justice Department. And now he even made a joke saying that he didn't know in the first 10 months of his of being on this job that he'd be staring down the barrel of a contempt citation, because that's what the Republican members of Congress, at least some of them, are saying that needs to be done. But look, I think part of the issue here is that members of Congress have an expectation that they're frankly moving the goalposts, right? They have produced, as Manu pointed out, 880,000 pages of documents. 100 staffers are working as hard as they can, according to the Justice Department, to produce these documents. And every time they meet a certain requirement, the documents that they've asked for, the Republicans come back with some new requests. There's a new letter that just went out just in the last few days. And so there's a moving of the goalposts that the Justice Department is trying to figure out how to meet, while at the same time protecting this ongoing investigation by Robert Mueller and the Russia investigation, which is still ongoing. The one last thing I'd point out is that Trey Gowdy and his soliloquy that he went on there against Rod Rosenstein, there wasn't much of an exchange. But Gowdy was railing about how long this investigation has been going on, which is just over a year. If you remember, Trey Gowdy oversaw the Benghazi investigation, which was for a couple of years, cost about $8 million. And if he also was saying that members of Congress in the Democratic side are, frankly, assuming that President Trump is guilty of something. And if you look at the coverage of Trey Gowdy during the Benghazi hearings, that's exactly what Republicans were accused of doing. So it looks like partisan politics is at play in some of these hearings today.
Yeah, don't try to apply consistency here, Evan. That's not allowed, especially in an election year in Washington. Stay with us. With me in studio to share their reporting and their insights, Jackie Kucinich with The Daily Beast, Michael Scher with The New York Times, Bloomberg, Sahil Kapoor, and Mary Catherine Hamm with The Federalist. I want everybody to listen here. Again, Rod Rosenstein tries to keep his cool. During his remarks, he essentially went out of his way, and you have to read into this because he doesn't say it directly, but he's essentially saying, I'm the Deputy Attorney General. I have to follow the law. I'm not a Republican member of the House who can say whatever he or she wants on television.
I've devoted almost 30 years to the service of my country. In my line of work, we keep an open mind, and we complete our investigations before we allege wrongdoing by anybody. Our allegations are made under oath and supported by credible evidence. Ignore the tyranny of the news cycle, stick to the rule of law, and make honest decisions that will always withstand fair and objective review.
His own understated way, but that was Rod Rosenstein essentially telling House Republicans to take a hike. But they kept asking the questions.
Well, they kept asking the questions because, in part, what they want is not answers. What they want is coverage of themselves asking the questions. Because, right. in large part, you know, this is part of this hearing, as all these other hearings have been, is part of not a kind of genuine search for answers, but rather a kind of consistent and methodical effort to undermine the legitimacy of an investigation that they fear. If it leads to a place, that it could lead to a place of real political damage to the president, to the people around the president, and ultimately to the Republican Party. And so this is a big show, and you saw, I think, Rosenstein getting really kind of upset finally and kind of breaking through a little bit of that anger at the show as opposed to the fact that it's not genuine.
Right, and for those who don't remember, it was the Attorney General, because of his role in the Trump campaign, Jeff Sessions recused himself early on. So it was Rod Rosenstein, who after the James Comey firing, who appointed Robert Mueller as the special counsel. Rod Rosenstein says he has followed all the practices. He has checked with the ethics people at the Justice Department about whether he should recuse himself. He says he's following the rules. Here's a question here from one of the Republicans, Ron DeSantis here, running for governor of Florida, one of the Republicans who has alleged essentially that the deep state, the Trump Justice Department, is trying to undermine the Trump presidency, asking Rosenstein, why are you still here?
Seems like you should be recused from this more so than Jeff Sessions. Why haven't you done that?
If it were appropriate for me to recuse, I'd be more than happy to do so and let somebody else handle this.
as Michael said, a lot of this is theater. And, you know, you heard Rosenstein at one point say, these are Trump appointees doing this, trying to really hammer home that this is not it. Because initially you heard a lot of Obama's deep state, blah, blah, blah. he made the point of noting that these are Trump appointees who are making these decisions. Several members of Congress do not care. This is much more for the clip factory than the actual, House of Representatives. But as you said, I mean, I really can't expand on it. He didn't think he would be here. You have to really remind yourself that this is a Republican official that Republicans are going after.
Those members of Congress see themselves getting closer and closer to an election where this is looming large. They want to find evidence. They want these documents so they can look at them and find evidence to advance their narrative about this investigation being, in the words of the president, a witch hunt. Trey Gowdy talked about this, finish it the hell up. A few prior investigations, Whitewater lasted 7 years, Watergate lasted 4 years, Iran-Contra 6 years. This is just a little over a year in. I don't think, historically speaking, this has gone on for a particularly long time at this point.
But this is, the hearing ostensibly is for the FBI director and the deputy attorney general to talk about the inspector general's report on the Clinton email investigation, where the Republicans do have legitimate concerns about the conduct of some FBI agents, principally Peter Strzok, who was on the Clinton email investigation, went over for a short period of time on the Mueller investigation. When Mueller heard about these texts, stop Trump, we'll stop Trump, clear Trump bias in the text. Again, the FBI says it didn't affect his work, but it certainly affected his mood. But they have a legitimate issue, but they seem to be taking that into some much grander conspiracy theory, essentially saying that the deputy attorney general appointed by Donald Trump, now the new FBI director appointed by Donald Trump, are part of this somehow nefarious Justice Department effort to undermine the Republican president who gave them their jobs.
I'm of two minds of this. One, it is literally their job to oversee this, and it's absolutely essential that elected officials oversee appointed officials, especially law enforcement, who has the force of law and the force of imprisonment and the force of violence to go after citizens. That being said, it's a congressional testimony and hearing, which means it is inevitably ridiculous, even though it is essential. But all that being said, there are real problems. And I think one of the issues and one of the sort of the dynamic you're seeing here, with less with Rosenstein than with a Comey or with others who have testified in the past, is this idea that they're above having made mistakes and that law enforcement is full of just nothing but perfect actors who cannot be held accountable for what they've done wrong. Well, people do need to be held accountable for what they've done wrong. Peter Strzok, as of now, remains in a job, and it remains to be seen what happens. And he's got three FBI lawyers answering questions for him in front of the people he is supposed to be answerable to. So the things to be upset about, I'm not sure that this is the way to
And to that point, the FBI director was asked about what disciplinary proceedings will take place, and he said, I'm not going to talk about that publicly because I'm not going to taint the proceedings, which are going on and the like.
Which will take another year.
Yeah, right. one of the interesting dynamics here is you have the Democrats coming to the defense of two Trump appointees, Rod Rosenstein and Christopher Wray here, after Trey Gowdy made his soliloquy, well put by Evan Paris, about what's up with the pace of the Mueller investigation. Listen here, a Democratic congressman asking a question, essentially characterizing, is Bob Mueller somebody who's slow walking or going to keep looking until he finds something?
Director Mueller understands that I want him to conclude it as expeditiously as possible, consistent with his responsibility to do it right.
Has anybody ever accused Director Mueller, Special Counsel Mueller, of being dilatory, lazy, slow?
I certainly haven't, sir.
My own experience and familiarity with Director Mueller is that none of those adjectives would describe too much of anything he's done in his career for this country.
I think Evan Perez is still with us. If you are, Evan, it's impossible, right, to get Director Mueller or Special Counsel Mueller to respond to any of this. He does his speaking only through court documents, right?
That's right. You don't hear very much except for no comment from the Special Counsel's office. And look, I do think that the problem here, the Pete Strzok problem, the FBI agent who sent those inappropriate texts, those things have done a job here to undermine what Mueller and what the FBI have been doing. I think you cannot get away from those facts. And so the FBI and the Justice Department are under an obligation to try to answer the questions from members of Congress. But I do think that sometimes if you watch these hearings, these are co-equal branches of government. And if you want to do a civics lesson, it doesn't mean that Congress, has superior powers over the executive branch. It just means that they're going to have to duke it out. And maybe Congress will never really be satisfied so long as this investigation is still going on, because they're not really going to get all of the answers that they think that they're entitled to while this investigation is still going on.